Liza Minnelli was born in one of show business's royal families, and she then went on to become a major star in her own right. She may be larger than life, but her life has also been filled with real struggle on a very human scale. Minnelli was born on March 12, 1946, the daughter of Judy Garland and director Vincent Minnelli. That might sound like a ticket straight to stardom, but it came with a ton of baggage. Hollywood's mistreatment of Garland is the stuff of legend, and years of abuse left her in a fragile mental and physical state from a young age. Once Minnelli was old enough to help, she became responsible for her mother. While Garland struggled with addiction, her daughter kept an eye on her. As Minnelli's first husband, Peter Allen, once explained to Rolling Stone, when she was a kid, a doctor told her that Judy could not take more than a couple of Nembutals a day, that more might kill her, but that she had to believe she was taking more, so it was up to Liza to empty out more of the capsules and fill them with sugar. According to Minnelli, it was a normal thing for her mother to lock herself in the bathroom after announcing that she was going to overdose. But Minnelli insisted that she just wanted attention. There were good memories, and Minnelli did love her mother, but the struggles affected her into adulthood. As she told Rolling Stone, "She could be a terror. I got used to her tantrums, scenes, though now I still can't stand to hear anybody yell. I can't stand temperament. Screaming, fighting, I will run from it at any cost." By the late 60s, Judy Garland was destitute and supporting her family by performing in bars for $100 a night. By the time Minnelli was 21, she'd been kicked out of hotels for an inability to pay, and she'd also been homeless, sleeping in Central Park and on the Plaza Fountain. As she recalled to Rolling Stone in 1973, "A lot of times we had to sneak out of hotels because she was out of bread, and she would make an incredibly funny game out of it. We would put on all the clothes we could, about 5 layers, and just walk out, leaving the rest laughing. Mama'd say, 'Oh hell, I needed a new wardrobe anyway.'" When it came to starting her own career, Minnelli was on her own as she talked herself into an off-Broadway musical. She got some experience touring with her mother as a governess and self-described crying towel. When it came time to set out on her own path, her famous background was her biggest obstacle. As she put it to Variety, "The hardest part was getting to be known as myself, as opposed to somebody's daughter." Judy Garland died in 1969 at the age of 47. The official cause was an overdose of barbiturates. That left her 23-year-old daughter to grieve her mother's untimely death in a very public place. She permitted herself to cry only once, in the car on the way to Manhattan after receiving the news. Minnelli then stood up to the massive pressure to have a very public funeral, as she instead decided it was going to be a private ceremony, with only yellow roses and help from an MGM makeup man who'd previously worked with Garland. Minnelli was also confronted with a daunting realization, as everyone was going to be writing a book about her mother and telling their versions of stories that she didn't necessarily agree with. And that's when she knew that she had to set the record straight with her own book, written as only a beloved daughter could.
"Was she a good mother?"
"The best."
On March 4th, 1967, the New York Times ran a tiny blurb about Liza Minnelli's very private first marriage to singer-songwriter Peter Allen. It was a rocky union, and there were a few reasons for that, including the fact that he was gay. There was more to it, though, and when Minnelli shared some of the behind-the-scenes details with Rolling Stone in 1973, she revealed that one of the biggest conflicts they had as a couple was that her career was taking off, and his wasn't. She was, after all, riding high on the success of Cabaret, and that was tough for Allen to deal with. At the time, as Minnelli saw it, women were still very much groomed to believe that they needed to get married and settle down. But that life wasn't for her, and even though Allen was always a good friend, her success got in the way. As she put it, "You're married. A guy's career goes well, swell. But the girl's does and his doesn't, and it's panic time. He'd say, 'You never come home anymore to cook supper.' I'd say, 'I have to work to make the money to buy the food to cook the supper.' He'd say, 'I'm the man. I should be making the money to buy the food.'" Their marriage ultimately ended in 1974. Minnelli has experienced multiple miscarriages, details of which are, understandably, scarce. But when she was interviewed by The Guardian in 2008, she mentioned one of the babies that she'd lost. She revealed that she's unable to eat before performing, as she elaborated, "I have a hiatal hernia, which I got when I was pregnant, and they put me upside down, trying to hold the baby. And the baby passed away anyway." Minnelli quickly changed the subject in that interview, but she has spoken about how much she regretted never having children, how devastating the losses of her pregnancies were, and how deeply they affected her. Altogether, she suffered 3 miscarriages before accepting that she would never have children. As she told Saga magazine in 2013, "It's one of my life's true regrets." Seeing her mother spiral into addiction took a toll on Liza Minnelli, but things changed after Garland's passing in 1969. That's when doctors prescribed Valium to help Minnelli sleep, and that's also when her own addiction to pills and alcohol began. She spent time at several rehab facilities over the years, which she's always been upfront about. As she told The Guardian in 2008, "My whole life, this disease has been rampant. I inherited it, and it's been horrendous, but I've always asked for help." Minnelli didn't take her first drink until she was 30 years old, but afterwards, she fell deeper and deeper into drugs and alcohol. Things got so bad that in 1984, her sister, Lorna Luft, had to effectively kidnap her to save her by borrowing Frank Sinatra's plane to fly her to the Betty Ford Clinic in California. Minnelli has struggled to make sense of her addiction, as she attempted to explain it during a 2006 interview on the Actors Studio. "Nobody would do that if they had seen the things that I had seen, unless they couldn't help it. This is a disease, and the sooner we know that, the better." When concert producer David Gest first hooked up with Liza Minnelli, a ton of rumors flew about, including that he was more interested in her money than her. Nevertheless, they married in 2002, though they split just 16 months later, and it was one of the most dramatic divorces in Hollywood history. Along with the split came a $10 million lawsuit against Minnelli, in which Gest claimed that she'd physically abused him so badly that he had to go to the hospital. As he alleged in an NBC News interview, "She just kept hitting me in the head with her fists over and over and over. The pain was so enormous that I get now 80 shots around the head to deaden the nerves." Gest also claimed that the attacks left him suffering from headaches, vertigo, insomnia, and hypertension, and that he needed 11 daily medications to deal with the pain. Minnelli countersued and accused Gest of stealing from her, while also claiming that living with him left her afraid for her life, as she alleged that he'd been poisoning her. Divorce proceedings continued for about another 4 years, and ultimately ended with a no-fault divorce and Minnelli swearing that she was never going to get married again. Indeed, during a 2012 appearance on Access Hollywood, she quipped, "If you even hear I'm getting married, hit me over the head and take me out of there."
I don't know if you want to talk about this, but I was at your wedding.
Which one?
I hope the last one.
Oh, you bet it was.
Having a best friend can make life complete. And for Liza Minnelli, that best friend was the fashion designer, Halston. They had a fantastic working relationship, as he designed her most memorable clothes, and she was always front and center if he needed a model. As she declared in the 2010 documentary, Ultra Suede, In Search of Halston, "He was my big brother. I loved him. I trusted him."
That he single-handedly changed American fashion.
Minnelli has had nothing but praise for Halston and has said that some of the best times she spent with him involved just hanging out, grabbing a bite to eat, and listening to each other. But tragically, their time together ended way too early. In 1989, Halston was diagnosed with AIDS, and by March 1990, he was dead at the age of 57. Minnelli organized a tribute to him at the Lincoln Center in 1992, in which she described him as tender always, courageous always, challenging always, daring me to be better than I ever thought I could be. I'll miss him always. In the years since, she's been an unfailing protector of his legacy. She's also led the charge in the fight against AIDS and the stigma that goes along with it. She's done a massive amount of charity work and was honored with the International Hero Award in 2003, during which she said, "I will do anything in this fight to help find a cure for this devastating disease. We have a long way to go in the fight ahead of us, and I will always be a part of that battle." In 2000, paramedics were summoned to Liza Minnelli's Florida home. They initially thought that she was suffering from a severe stroke, but it turned out that it was actually complications from something called viral encephalitis, which is contracted through a mosquito bite. Encephalitis is an inflammation of the brain, and severe cases can be life-threatening. Symptoms range from paralysis and seizures to difficulty speaking, hallucinations, and falling into a coma. Minnelli was told that she was never going to walk again, and that she needed to accept that she was going to be reliant on a wheelchair. But despite the dire diagnosis, she had other ideas and ultimately made a full recovery. It was anything but easy, though. As she told The Guardian in 2008, "I had to learn to walk again, had to learn to talk again. People don't usually recover like I recovered, but I would not give up. I was lying there, scared, and my father always told me, the way you do something is you think about it. I really work to get back. Most people don't come through it."
Where there's a will, there's a way.
If you watch Liza Minnelli dance, you'll swear she was born to do it. But it's taken a severe toll on her, and she's had to undergo numerous surgeries and procedures to stay on her feet. As she told Saga magazine in 2013, "I'm Dorothy's daughter up top and the Tin Man down below." And that's hardly an exaggeration. Her problems go back a long way, and for a while, she didn't even realize that she was unconsciously adjusting the way she walked and moved to relieve the pain of scoliosis. In fact, she only noticed it when she saw someone impersonating her and her distinctive walk. In 2014, she had to undergo back surgery. She's also suffered from crushed discs in her back, and she's had two hip replacements and a knee replacement. But true to form, less than a year later after that knee replacement, she was once again dancing every day.
"My name is Liza. Liza."
If you or someone you know is struggling with substance abuse and mental health, please contact SAMHSA's 24-hour national helpline at 1-800-662-HELP 4357.